The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end."
Lost in darkness, have seen a light. The Savior promised, revealed tonight. Those hearts in waiting, they wait no more. This manger baby, this is the Lord. Let peace arise, let darkness fall.
There were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased."
If they're holy, When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them, until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh.
Thank you. Good evening. If you have your Bibles, please open up to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, we're going to be in verse 14. If you don't know me, my name is Thomas Anderson. I'm one of the associate pastors here. And it's awesome that we can gather together to sing and hear about our King, Lord Jesus. But just for a moment, just for a few minutes, we're going to reflect on the Word of God and the God of the Word. If you're open to John, I would like to read verse 14 for us. John 1, 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. I have sort of an unusual question for you this evening. Maybe you can determine if it's unusual or not, but it's an unusual Christmas question. And the question is, if you were given the choice, would you be physically actually born again? Hypothetically, of course. I'm not asking literally, but hypothetically, would you be born again physically in the hospital knowing everything that you know now? How would you answer that question? Would you do it again knowing everything that you know? Why? Why not? Now, maybe on our good days, we might think, yeah, I would definitely do it again. I have a good family, love my family, I lived a good life, I would do it again in a heartbeat. But maybe on our bad days, we might think, no. No, I would not do it again. No one in their right mind would actually do it again knowing everything that I know. Just think about the hurt, the pain, the decay, the sorrow, the trial, the loss, the tears, the suffering, the death. But I would propose to you this evening, friends, that this question gets to the heart of Christmas. This question, would you be born in a world like this? And it's because there's only one person who ever actually had to answer that question, and it had actual ramifications for their life. That is the person of Jesus. And we actually see Jesus' answer in John chapter 1, verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Think about the philosophy and theology of that one statement for a minute. Why would Jesus, the pre-incarnate Word of God, the second person of the Trinity, not created, eternally begotten of the Father from all eternity past, very God of very God, why would the second person of the Trinity take on human flesh? Why? Well, at this point, we might be tempted to actually import our own motivations on Jesus. We might think Jesus was having a midlife crisis and he needed to somehow prove himself. Or maybe you might think, Jesus was getting a little bit bored with eternity. It was just the mundane daily routine, day in, day out for all eternity. He just needed a change of pace. Or you might think, well, Jesus actually owed it to us. He felt obligated to come among his creation. But in all of this, right here at Christmas, we must remember that Jesus is not like us in this sense. He doesn't have midlife crises. He's not dissatisfied with his eternity without us. Jesus is not like us in this sense. While we feel insecure, Jesus is not insecure about his status as God. While we need affirmation and approval from others, Jesus needs no praise or affirmation from anyone at any time. While we need praise, a raise, a smile, or a nod of approval, Jesus needs none of this, friends. He is completely and utterly self-sufficient in and of himself, perfectly content from all eternity to eternity with or without us. Now, consider that first moment when Jesus entered into our world as we know it. His mother and father lean in and see this baby that was promised thousands of years before. We see the wise men travel from a far distance because they followed his star to seek God's gift to the world. We see the scene of shepherds receiving a message that the Messiah, that is the anointed one, who had been prophesied about for thousands of years, is now here, and so they run to see the Messiah. And we see angels, the scene of angels, singing in celestial joy in the heavenly places, praising God about peace that has come to man, joy that has come to mankind in this gift, Jesus Christ in the flesh, the God baby in the flesh, in a wooden cradle. To really understand this, to truly experience the fact that Jesus came to dwell with us, we must look at Jesus' life That is, his moment from the wooden cradle until his coronation in exaltation. So just in three brief movements, we will look at these. The first movement of Jesus' earthly life can be considered in two wooden bookends. The first wooden bookend is the wooden cradle, and the final wooden bookend is the cross, the wooden cross. Now think about Jesus' earthly life between the cradle and the cross. He came as the God-man and lived the perfect life that we could never live but should have lived. When Jesus came, he was just like us in every way, wasn't he? He was actually man. He was actually human, which means, friends, he was tempted. He was hungry. He got tired. He slept. He cried. In fact, he even died as the God-man here in the flesh. But it was all without sin. He perfectly lived the life that we should have lived but could have never lived. And Jesus also says in Mark, he says, I actually came to be a ransom. That is a substitution. So what we see Jesus' life in this wooden, from the wooden cradle to the wooden cross, is that his life is actually a substitution. The perfect substitution in our place. He didn't just come to show us what the perfect life looked like. He came to live the perfect life on our behalf as a substitution. So that if we put our faith in him, we might have the same position as if we obeyed God just like Jesus. That's the first movement, from cradle to cross. The second movement is Jesus' cry upon the cross. As Jesus is hanging upon the cross, he cries, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? An interesting thing for the God-man to cry upon the cross, isn't it? But he cries this, why have you forsaken me? Because he was forsaken so that we might be forgiven. So that if we put our faith in him, we see that not only was his life a substitution, his perfect life, but also his death is a substitution for us as well. That he takes the curse of sin, all of the shame and guilt and punishment that we deserve because of our sin, because we've offended God, Jesus took upon the cross so that we might receive cleansing and forgiveness. He is our substitution upon the cross, and he did it because sin needed to be dealt with. And he did it because he loves us. That's the second movement. The third movement is from the cross to Jesus' coronation. And the coronation is Jesus' exaltation, taking the throne and taking the crown of a king in his coronation, like the king ascends into his palace, to his mighty throne. And in his coronation, the scriptures actually say that he not only lived on our behalf as a substitution and died on our behalf as a substitution, but he also raised for our justification, so that putting your faith in Jesus, you might receive the life, the benefits of Jesus' life, and receive the benefits of Jesus' death, but also receive the benefits of Jesus' resurrection, and that though we die in this mortal body, we will not truly die, but we look forward to a resurrection just like Jesus's. And so, from the cross to the coronation, in this third movement, we really learn why Jesus came. He came to be our substitution in his life, death, and resurrection because he loves us. And friends, I don't know where you're at, but perhaps this Christmas is the time to start thinking about being born again. And not being born again physically, but spiritually. What does it mean to put your faith in Jesus Christ? Because Jesus talks about it as if it is new life that is given to you. A resurrection life. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead can be yours by faith and by faith alone. Not by good works, not by doing any good thing in your life, but just by faith in Jesus and by faith alone. And so this Christmas, may we be reminded that the God baby, Jesus Christ, came to be born in order to die as a substitution, in order to live as a substitution, in order to be raised as a substitution because he loves. And may we put our faith in him and find true life this Christmas.
Oh, to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Born into this world, walking beside us, living among us, born to save, born to redeem, born that man no more may die. It's overwhelming to think about the cost of our redemption. Only the perfect love of a perfect God could offer such a gift to us. That gift is Jesus, the one true God and King, yet so humble that he would be born into this world and die a criminal's death on a cross. even though he was perfect and without sin. Lord Jesus, in this moment, we celebrate the fact that you came to us. We acknowledge that it is because of your unending, unfailing love, your mercy and grace, that we have the opportunity to be born again, born from above. We worship you forever.